Come your joke and cook your bonnet, swing your kilt as best as ye can. Andrew Dobton's drubs are drilling, come your joke and kill your man. Scotland is basically in a weird limbo, as in Edinburgh and London are so linked, it is basically Great Britain. But Scotland was unique, it had unique cultures, unique traditions, and they were so much different from Britain, even though they were not politically or industrially, but they were culturally. Pipers, kilts, and of course haggis. Oh my. For 300 years, the pipes have played in peace and in war, from the streets of Glasgow to the trenches of Belgium and France, and all over World War II as well, for glory, inspiration, a warrior tradition, and also to remember the pipers that came before them. These were the Scots of the trenches, the pipers of the trenches of World War I. In the Great War, pipers would go over the top, not without Webleys or SMLEs, but of course bagpipes. In the fights of German machine guns and self-preservation, they would go over the top. They would be the first to get out of their trenches and march as they played their comrades into battle. More than 250,000 men were pipers in World War I, and only half survived the Great War. Scottish pipers were not so Scottish as you think, though, as from all over the empire, from Nova Scotia to New Delhi, by pipers were all over the empire. Being part of the British Union, the Scottish were mobilised as Britain went to war, from July 1914 till its end in August 1918. Over 5 million men served in the British Army. Not all regiments had to wear kilts, as some wore the standard British khaki uniforms of 1907 and 1903, but all regiments had to have a piper in it. As soon as the war started, they were sent all around the world, from South Africa to Gallipoli, but most were stationed on the Western Front. But at the first Battle of Loos in France, a Scottish legend would be born at Loos, Daniel Logan Leagle. They played at Gallipoli, they played at the Somme, they played at Vimy Ridge, and even as the war came to a close, as they marched close to the Rhine, you could hear the pipers playing. Well, this is basically the meat of the video, like I said, Scotland and England were so tied together, and the Union wasn't as shaky as, well, Ireland or even India. But a few traditions did live on, and we're going to cover just a bit more, honestly. You know, to give Scotland that, you know, Minority Report feel, we're just going to cover kilts, haggis, we covered bagpipes. We covered the Black Watch in the next episode. That they're going to go out simultaneously as soon as this is edited. Black Watch is right out the door. So let's focus on kilts and maybe the Tam O'Shanter and some other stuff as well. So let's see what we can find. I couldn't find anything on Scotland, sorry. But just like Braveheart, these men from the Highlands and some from the Lowlands, who are not discriminating here, they were reliable, trustworthy, warriors, and they were always ready to die for the Union of Great Britain. And that's all I have for you today of Scotland. Sorry it was so short and so meaningless, but like I said before, like 4 times already, Scotland and England are so linked together as the Great Union of Great Britain that they are industrially and politically the same country of sorts. But they did have their traditions. They had their kilts, their haggis, their Tam O'Shanters, their Dangleary hats, the checkered hat with the black, and of course it would be later brownish because, you know, camouflage and standardization. But even though Britain allowed these small little things, the sheiks wore the hijab and stuff like this, Britain was not as kind as you think, you know. Britain actually wanted Britification. Every colony had to speak English, or even if it was broken English, they had to speak it. Just like Russia and France before them, Britishification was a real thing. But the Scottish still broke through these molds and still had their Tam O'Shanters and their haggis, and of course their kilts and their bagpipes, and even some had Highlander swords. And even a famous legend of World War II, Mad Jack Churchill, went on to Normandy, the D-Day, with a Highlander sword and a bow and arrow. A real Braveheart of the 20th century. But that is all we have today for Scotland in World War One. World War Two is a bit different. They kind of see the secession away from Britain as Australia, New Zealand, even India tries to start breaking away. South Africa, well, mostly the white majority in South Africa, but the blacks as well in other colonial possessions in Africa. The Caribbeans are starting to break away. So in World War II, it's a bit more tension and it's a bit more nationalized and a bit more stuff is going on in Scotland. But for World War I, they are content with the union with Greater Britain. But of course, not all people are, you know, so content with the relation with Britain, such as Wales or maybe Ireland, maybe New Zealand after Gallipoli, of course, Australia as well. The Aboriginals are not really content with the Australians. A whole lot of dichotomy, a whole lot of domestic issues in later episodes, but this is pretty good so far. Hope you learned something. Hope you were not offended by how short this Scottish video was and me talk for like 2 minutes, but I hope you enjoyed. Do not provoke without immunity, my friends. So we shall play Amazing Grace as we finish this ceremony of great Scottish triumph on the Western Front. Of course, Gallipoli, and of course, Salonika and Jerusalem as well. Play the bagpipe. No, wait, I sound Irish, but let's play this before people realise. Amazing Grace. Okay, I almost forgot, but this video is dedicated to my wonderful, well, Mimim daughter, Cat, and also my good friend, Lynn. They're both from Scotland. So sorry this episode is kind of short. Hopefully the Black Watch episode would kind of make up for it, even though it's mostly military doctrine. But thanks for being there, you know, thanks for being cool, and thanks for being some pretty cool Scottish people as well. So this one's dedicated to you. Of course, this is dedicated to all the people of Scotland and Scottish heritage, but, you know, just be making videos and having people in mind. Pretty cool, pretty cool. I guess, you know, as people come along, you know, the nations would be dedicated to people that I know, but of course it'd be dedicated to the country. But this is just a quick add-on, so I don't want to make it over like 10 minutes, so this one goes out to Kat and Lynn. Enjoy. Even though it's kind of at the end of the video. Oh well, gotta get to the end then.